Blog Talk Radio.
Thank you for joining us this evening. This is Sunday, October 18, 2015. This is the Humanity Party radio talk show. I am Anonymous. I'm the host of the show. This show is, of course, we're launching the Humanity Party worldwide. And it's an effort, we're making an effort to organize this political party that represents all of Earth's inhabitants. Our efforts, to the chagrin of many conspiratorialists, religious people, and others out there who simply do not understand humanity and have even less of a desire to bring us all together and unify us into one group so we can try to find some peace among us. We want a new world order and one government which runs everything upon this earth according to the needs and wants of the people. That's a big goal that we put before us, but it's something we're going to do. And to do so, to launch this, we're going to launch it. There's no real set time when this is going to launch, but those of you who have followed the Humanity Party and know about the video that was created to launch the Vote Anonymous, please understand that the Vote Anonymous concept is still there. We are in hopes that people will find more interest in it by next summer before the elections. But we're up against the entire world that's pretty apathetic about politics, and nothing's to blame them for that. There's just simply no hope. Things have never changed, and it seems like there's no political party that has stepped up to present anything worthwhile that the people can really get excited about. Every single U.S. presidential election, people get excited about change. No real change occurs because it can't. We've explained those things. But the Humanity Party is going to produce a video, and that video is going to be what the world is going to hear. So tonight, I'm going to present the introduction, how it's going to sound. And keep in mind, there'll be background music. The video will have a lot of visuals that the producers will put together. But I'm going to record this evening the actual words that will be used. So after the recording is done, I'd like anybody who would like to call in and let's critique it. It's our party, all of ours. The voice of humanity remains anonymous for the sake of unity, for the sake of not any one person be put above another in this very important thing that we're trying to do. So that said, let me introduce the Humanity Party of the world. The way that we're going to do it, take notes, and after I'm through, please call in and give your opinions, your critiques, whatever might help us to present this message to the world. The Worldwide Humanity Party, creating a new world order under a united world government. Sovereignty threatens peace and unity. We need to unite as a people, one people, upon this earth, and end all sovereign powers. At no time during the history of the earth has a political group existed representative of the entire human race. We have allowed ourselves to be divided into separate nations and governments. We have never attempted to join together as one people, as one species that works together as individuals for the betterment and sake of the whole. We have been convinced that sovereignty is more important than unity and peace. Sovereignty is best defined as state of having rightful, independent, and supreme power or authority in governing the people of a state or community. How can any sovereign group of people unite with another sovereign group when each group feels that it is their prerogative and right to independence and supreme power and authority? Folks, you're going to have to forgive me. I'm going to have to start again. I forgot to push the button on the official recording for the mic that records the good parts, that records it properly outside of the show. Bear with me as we try this again. The Worldwide Humanity Party, creating a new world order under a united worldwide government. Sovereignty threatens peace and unity. We need to unite as one people upon one earth and end all sovereign powers. At no time during the history of the earth has a political group existed representative of the entire human race. We have allowed ourselves to be divided into separate nations and governments. We have never joined together as one people, as one species, that works together as individuals for the betterment and sake of the whole. We have been convinced that sovereignty is more important than unity and peace. Sovereignty is best defined as, quote, the quality or state of having rightful, independent, and supreme power or authority in governing the people of a state or community, unquote. How can any sovereign group of people unite with another sovereign group when each group feels that it is their prerogative and right to independence and supreme power and authority? True unification of separate sovereign powers is impossible, and its attempt futile. Our united nations is an oxymoron. No matter what ambitious politician or statesman might proclaim, no nation upon earth is united with any other, nor can they be when sovereignty is involved. It can never happen when sovereignty is the basis of any form of people or government. The Charter of the United States outlines its own hypocrisy and gives good reason for its inefficient. I'm going to periodically reread certain parts so as not to. When I stumble, this can all be taken apart. This can all be done by our producers anyway. So bear with me. The Charter of the United Nations outlines its own hypocrisy and gives a good reason for its inefficiency and the lack of unity that could bring world peace. Article 2 of the Charter states, organization of its members in pursuit of the purposes stated in Article 1 shall act in accordance with the following principles. 1. The organization is based on the principle of the sovereign equality of all its members. Unquote. Again, how can the principle of sovereign equality exist when sovereignty is the quality or state of having rightful, independent, and supreme power or authority in governing the people of a state or community? A group of people that thinks its ways and laws are right will never cooperate with another group of people that just as strongly believes that their own are. Let me read that again. A group of people that thinks its ways and laws are right will never cooperate with another group of people that just as strongly believes that its own are. Each group will fight for its positions and opinions. Sovereignty is responsible for every war of bloodshed and terror that has ever afflicted humankind. Unity, when experienced, can promote peace, cooperation, and humane and equal laws. The United States gives us the perfect example of this. United under a central government, the people of the United States have enjoyed peace and security. Yet states that disagree with one another and proclaim their sovereignty threaten and continue to threaten the concept of a United States of America. The U.S. Civil War, in which more Americans lost their lives than in all foreign wars combined, was the result of states fighting against each other for power and to maintain their perceived sovereignty. Most of the social problems, if not all, encountered within the United States are a result of individual states demanding their rightful, independent, and supreme power or authority in governing the people who live within the boundaries of the established states. Liberal freedom for all people would not exist in the United States if some individual states were granted their absolute sovereignty. For example, and this is just one of many, some states do not want homosexuals to marry. Others concede that it's okay and within the rights of all humans to choose whom they desire to love. This one thing divides Americans, causes anger, strife, turmoil. What has worked for the United States is found in the premise of its Constitution. Quote, "We, the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America." Unquote. The intent was to, quote, "form a more perfect union among us, not a division of separate sovereign authorities." Unfortunately, the arguments presented by the differing opinions of an elected Congress interpret and amend the original intent of the U.S. Constitution. One of the many examples of this is how some members of Congress ignored the original intent of the U.S. Constitution in the belief that Americans have the right to bear arms outside of a, quote, "well-regulated militia," unquote. Although not part of the original Constitution, this Second Amendment specifically outlines the purpose for which the people are given the right to bear arms. Quote, "A well-regulated militia, being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed." Unquote. The mistake made in the Second Amendment's wording has led to the United States being the most domestically violent nation upon earth. U.S. guns kill more civilians in the United States than in all other nations upon earth combined. Some U.S. states fight vehemently to protect the right of their citizens to bear arms. This amendment should have been written, quote, "A well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free union of people," unquote. There was never any intent by the original authors of the Constitution to allow people to bear arms against each other outside of a There was never any intent by the original authors of the Constitution to allow people to bear arms against each other outside of a well-regulated militia that would eventually include other law enforcement agencies not yet envisioned at the time by the Constitution's original authors. The purpose of the United Nations reflect the united consensus of peaceful and intelligent human beings and their desires. Article 1 of the United Nations Charter. The purpose of the United Nations are, 1, to maintain international peace and security, and to that end, to take effective collective measures for the prevention and removal of the threats to the peace and for the suppression of acts of aggression or other breaches of the peace, and to bring about by peaceful means and in conformity with the principles of justice and international law, adjustment or settlement of international disputes or situations which might lead to a breach of the peace. 2, to develop friendly relations among nations based on respect for the principle of equal rights and self-determination of peoples, and to take other appropriate measures to strengthen universal peace. 3, to achieve international cooperation in solving international problems of an economic, social, cultural, or humanitarian character, and in promoting and encouraging respect for human rights and for fundamental freedoms for all without distinction as to race, sex, language, or religion. And 4, to be a center for harmonizing the actions of nations in the attainment of these common ends. Yet Article 2 of the Charter describes the principles upon which the United Nations shall act. An honest review will reveal the reasons why the current United Nations does not and can never work properly in promoting peace on Earth. The United Nations wants to create world peace and prosperity without eliminating the very thing that stands in its way, the sovereignty of nations. Sovereignty must end. The only sovereignty that should exist is that of the individual and one's right to exist and pursue happiness according to one's desire for happiness, whatever that might be, as long as that pursuit of happiness does not affect the individual sovereignty of another. Human beings must unite under one world constitution, one government and authority. But what kind of constitution and government should this be? Dictatorship versus democracy. The people of the world have enough evidence to know which form of government works best for them. The current situation unfolding in the Middle East demonstrates the need for a dictatorship. Before the United States decided to invade Iraq, when the United States decided to invade Iraq and toppled its dictator Saddam Hussein in 2003. The stage was set for extreme violence and unrest that resulted in the consequence of the Arab Spring. Many established dictatorships were overthrown by the uprising of the people who had the support of the most powerful nation upon earth. The United States thought that the people of Iraq would welcome democracy. The United States often believes this about other countries. Before the intervention of the United States, these countries enjoyed relative peace, security, and better prosperity under their dictators. Democracy simply does not work for them. But why? Democracy does not protect the minority, nor allow for its rights. The history of human government in our current world should be all the proof we need to understand that it is impossible to trust any one of us, or a group of us, to treat all people equally and establish the perfect government. None of us can be trusted with power and authority over others, because it is part of our human nature to change our environment to fit our personal preferences. However, the world should be an environment that cannot be modified to adapt or react to the opinions and perspectives of any one individual or of a majority. All opinions and perspectives must be respected and protected. People exist, or they desire to exist, according to their individual desires of happiness. Those whom we elect by the voice of the majority would more than likely follow their own conscience and establish a government that served their personal interests. The current democratically elected and supported governments on our earth do not serve the people, but rather are served by the people through the taxation that the people are forced to abide by. The citizens are expected to serve these governments through patriotism. Some governments are set up to support their citizens in their individual efforts to enrich themselves and their families. However, these forms of government set up systems of class based on economic status that afford more opportunity and success to those of the higher classes. No democracy has ever met the important criteria of serving the needs of all the people of Earth equally. Even in the first ostensibly free democracy of the United States of America, the majority once believed it was right and proper to own other human beings as slaves in order to enrich their own families. They also denied women the rights that men enjoyed. When this so-called free democracy was first established, its majority also believed that the Native American Indians were a lower class of people. This justified the stronger majority with the stronger weapons to steal the Native Americans' land and destroy their quote-unquote savage way of life. Further back during the history of the earth, a majority of the most respected, refined, and educated people believed that the world was flat. A majority of the most respected, refined, and educated people believed that the world was flat. These ignorant ones were the same ones who ran the governments that control the people. Unfortunately, we have very little assurance today that those who are the most respected, the most refined, or the most educated people of our modern world, those who currently control the governments of the world, are not as ignorant as the majority of our ancestors. All of these facts show how and why a democracy formed by the voice and vote of the majority of free-willed people will never lead to lasting peace and happiness for all free-willed people equally. Most of the people living in the Middle East are Muslim. Their religion mandates reverence to just one man, Muhammad, the greatest dictator of law and justice known to Islam. From their youth, the people are conditioned to look to one person for authority and guidance. These people require a dictator. They need one. It is what they are accustomed to and what makes sense to them. Nevertheless, the problems of dictatorship arise when the dictator rules according to his personal beliefs and does not respect those who have differing opinions. But what would happen in the Middle East if there were a democratically elected Congress that established the laws instead of a dictator? The same thing that has happened and is currently happening in the United States. Congress. Gridlock caused by bipartisan. Let me read that again. The same thing that has happened and is currently happening in the United States Congress. Constant gridlock caused by bipartisan arguments and opinions. There are various factions of Islam that are fighting each other in the Middle East, all desiring to set up a government with a dictator that will protect their beliefs from the beliefs of others. What if there existed a dictator who protected all the people's beliefs and right to pursue individual happiness, and who had the power and authority to enforce protection of individual existence and belief? The proper world constitution must include the power of a strong dictatorship limited to the protection of individual rights only. But at the same time, this constitution must allow for a Congress of representatives of the people and their opinions and concerns. This dictator, or rather a president or prime minister of the world, should have the power and authority to protect the people's rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. But a Congress of representatives should be given the power to establish laws of the opinions of the people they represent. The world's president will be given the authority to protect and enforce inalienable rights that all humans desire equally, regardless of each person's individual or group-inspired opinions. These rights are easily defined. All humans desire the right to life, which includes nutritious food, secure housing, sufficient clothing, competent health and mental care, and education, and the right to be protected from physical harm because of one's belief. The Humanity Party offers a new constitution of the United People of Earth that does what a constitution is meant to do. It creates a body of fundamental principles and established precedents according to which the people of the world are unified and by which they acknowledge to be governed. The Constitution will outline specific human rights to which all people upon earth can agree. These specific rights will transcend the right of each individual to hold their own opinion, but offer protection of the privilege to do so. A world president, elected by the voice of the people during worldwide elections, will be given the power to enforce this world constitution. This elected official's authority and rights will be limited to the protection of the This elected official's authority and rights will be limited to the protection of the inalienable rights granted by a new world constitution. All aspects of government, including all military branches, shall be united under one authority and commander-in-chief. There will also be a world congress elected by the people that meets together and establishes the different laws. There will also be a world congress elected by the people that meets together and establishes the different laws under which all of Earth's human inhabitants shall be ruled by the same order of law and determined by these elected representatives. An example of these constitutional laws, the powers of this congress, is this. the right of belief and the pursuit of happiness. A. Congress shall establish laws that protect each person's right to act, to be acted upon, to believe, and to express opinion, where that action, belief, or expression of opinion does not affect, extend upon, to, or impede another person's right to act, to be acted upon, to believe, or to express opinion. B. Congress shall enact laws that protect any act in the pursuit of individual happiness, however and in whatever way that individual might define happiness, as long as the act does not diminish, obstruct, abuse, or in any other way impede another person's ability to act in the pursuit of happiness. There will be no more borders, no more sovereignty of separate nations. There shall be one world, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all people. The Humanity Party is the only way that this can be possible. The people of the world must unite under one cause, under one movement, utilizing the purpose of a political platform to bring about political unity and eventual change. The Humanity Party will introduce this platform, utilizing the best parts of the governments that have shown some success throughout our history upon this earth. The Humanity Party will modify existing government constitutions, documents, and sources to establish the concept of a new world order under a united world government. We, the people of the world, in order to form a more perfect union among us, to establish justice, to ensure worldwide tranquility, to provide for our common defense, to promote the general welfare and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and to our posterity, do ordain and establish this worldwide humanity party for all humankind upon earth. And there you have it, folks. Okay, let me quickly save that file so that the producer can take that. And again, the producers will be able to take my words and change them, whatever they must do, clean them up before they use them on the video. Phone lines are open. We would appreciate any questions or comments about that introduction. And remember, any part of that can be reread according to the producer's need. So we're not worried about any parts that my frail voice missed. Anyway, let's get some callers. Let's discuss this very, very important introduction to the Worldwide Humanity Party. Play a little music so I can get my voice back.
To dream the impossible dream, to fight the unbeatable foe, to bear with unbearable sorrow, to run the brave dare not go, to right the unrightable wrong, to love pure and chaste from afar, to try when your arms are too weary, to reach the unreachable star. This is my quest, to follow that star, no matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right, without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And I know, my heart will lie peaceful and calm when I'm laid to my rest. And the world will be better for this, that one man scorned and covered with scars, still strove with his last ounce of courage, to fight the unbeatable foe, to
Welcome back to the show. We are Anonymous. We're the organizers of the Worldwide Humanity Party. Let's go to our first caller here. Molly, you're on the air. Go ahead with your question or comment.
Hi, I was listening to your intro part about, you know, fitting the one world government. And I guess I'm just wondering if that means those, there will still be individual governments in every country, or are we completely doing away with those?
The sovereignty means that there's a group of people that live in the world that has divided themselves by borders into nations and the countries. That has caused all of our problems throughout the human race. We want to get rid of that and join the entire world under one united world government. We can do that now because of the technology available to us and the way that trade is going, the economic situation in the world that's headed that way anyway. So we want the people to decide and be in charge of just getting rid of sovereign nations and establishing one people, one group of human beings, and having one government that establishes the laws for us and that controls just one military, one law enforcement, one court system for all people equally. So yes, all nations will be gone, we hope.
Okay. So how would we vote on something like this? Because would it be that each country has to decide to join this, or it's not, you know, it's not like we have a world vote right now.
That's correct.
Now we all...
First, Molly, this is an uphill battle, as you might very well know. And what's going to happen with the technology that we have? It's very easy. Social media, we can have most people, a great majority of the people that are interested in politics, have access to a computer in the social media, whether it be Facebook, Twitter, whatever those things are out there. And it's through those, the social media, that voting can take place. Now, every human being offered a vote, they can go onto a website, a government website that's set up, that every person will have their own identity verified through various means to identify the one person. Now, each person would have to register to vote. Okay, and then they elect officials. The world would be, you can't have a huge Congress of 10,000 people. Okay, there's approximately 200 set-up nations now, and, you know, sovereign groups of people that might call themselves nations might not be recognized. But if we had just two representatives of each of those parts of the world that could meet together in Congress, it would be even less people than we have in the House of Representatives in the U.S. Congress. Okay, this is a long time in coming. This whole movement has to be accepted by the majority of the people of the world. They have to just disavow their governments and just want to unify themselves under one government. And it's practical
about
now.
About 60% of the world doesn't have access to internet, and you know, they're not educated, and they're not going to have a way to even understand this, much less. I mean, maybe they would understand it if we were able to explain it to them in simple terms, but I'm sure that they would be the ones who would probably advocate votes for it. However, they're not going to have a voice because they don't have the internet.
You're exactly right. And in any developed country in the world where the internet exists, where this technology exists, in any first world country, as we call them, the people, the majority of the people there have access to these things, and they're the ones who have the power. They're the ones who control the world for the other 99%. The fact is, 1% of the Earth's population, way less than 1% of the Earth's population, controls everything about what happens to the other 99%. We all know that. Okay, so what we're counting on is the people that are educated, that do have access to the internet, social media, and these things, who do actually participate in political movements and vote in whatever country they're in, that they will know about the Humanity Party, unite, and basically, at first, because the Humanity Party will never be accepted by the sovereign nations and governments that be. It's going to have to be a movement in the future as the people become more aware that finally there's one political party that represents all the people of the world. And that political party wants all people to get behind it. And now, Molly, I can sense, correct me if I'm wrong, that there is some little bit of trepidation on your part in seeing something like this go forward, can I ask you, what would be your opinion of what needs to be done to create more peace, more justice, more security upon this earth?
Oh, well, I have a plan called the Pocahontas Plan, and I think we should just put Tinder everywhere. And, well, I guess first we need to allow people to have, you know, basic necessities, access to, you know, clean water and all basic things throughout the world. That way they can, you know, survive and not be stressed out. But
And how is that done? So just, how do you make that happen?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think this plan seems like it really is the only thing that would work, because ultimately it has to be through government.
There you go.
And one thing that I was kind of confused about whenever I came across this work was, before I'd always kind of had this idea in my mind that charities and all the, you know, all the donations and stuff that churches give are ultimately doing a good thing. And then I think I read sort of a True Humanity post about, I guess, every time you are giving to someone, I mean, you look at someone who doesn't have anything and you think instinctively, oh, I'm helping them, I'm giving them something, but you're not actually printing more money into the government or into the economy. And ultimately the only way to, you know, that we're adding money to the economy is by printing it. If you look at, like, if you think about it rationally, there's X amount of people, you know, and there's only so much money. And the number of people keep having babies. That number keeps growing, but the number of money we're putting into the economy is not, unless we just print it.
Exactly right.
So,
and you do more research in the Humanity Party, especially a blog post that was put out today. You'll find more about money, and eventually we're going to produce a video that describes money. It's very simple. Very simple and easy thing to understand. Before printed money was even available to the people of the world, there was gold. And there was a gold standard and precious metals upon which most economies in the world were based. There's only so much gold, and it's usually owned by less than 1% of the people. Okay, in order for everybody else to participate in the economic situation, in the economic of the world, they must have the means of that participation, which is gold, and which now is money. And we have presented and described a perfect scenario using the game of Monopoly to show how it works in the world. The fact is, money needs to be printed, and it needs to go into the hands of the people who need it. But there's the argument of, once you do that, then inflation will be out of control.
Inflation.
That's mm-hmm. easily taken care of. If you have one world government, one world mm-hmm. government can create a law that establishes anti-inflationary policies mm-hmm. that says nobody mm-hmm. gets to raise their prices more than a certain percent each year. Mm-hmm. All these things are very common. Go ahead. Sorry.
This all makes sense, but I think the biggest argument that I've heard in regards to, you know, kind of a one world government or one, you know, inflation worldwide, law, you know, law, inflation laws worldwide, is that some countries simply aren't going to go for it, you know, and we can't, like, you know, bomb them and force them into anything.
That's right.
Force anyone to do anything.
It's going to take a united effort on the people of the world. If you've ever traveled to, for example, Iran and got to know the people, the Iranian youth, the Iranian people, they mm-hmm. want peace. They do not agree with
yeah.
their government. Okay, the only mm-hmm. ones that agree with their government are those who are hopeless and who have no economic security, no job to go to, no future. Therefore, they seek out mm-hmm. some value, and that's where they get involved in religion and these groups that become mm-hmm. terrorists. Groups,
mm-hmm.
and but the problem, the stem problem, the root problem is the impoverished people who don't have hope. And so mm-hmm. we are going to reach out in the future. This is probably going to take years and years for people to finally get sick and tired of domestic and foreign terrorism, mm-hmm. all the wars and rumors of wars, until mm-hmm. they finally realize everything that we have done. Every charity, every religion, every single government that has existed has done nothing to solve the problem. There's got to be mm-hmm. something better and something different. That's what the Humanity Party is all about. We are going to create the solutions, present them to the people of the world. This is what we can do, but we need everybody in every country to unite, vote against their government. Very simple. In a democratic government, you simply go to the voting booth and vote anonymous.
Mm-hmm.
Write in anonymous that you reject the current governments. That'll send a message. But if we could get enough people to support the Humanity Party, if we got enough people interested in it, and people just start talking about this unification of human beings, we could do it. We could pressure we could possibly give teeth to the United Nations. The United Nations exists as a pseudo world government, but it has no teeth. It has no real power. It has no real legislative authority, nor a court authority. And it really doesn't have the power of a strong worldwide united military to enforce certain humane laws. So all these things are basically, people will say this is just a utopian idea, a mm-hmm. socialist idea
they
that
do.
Will
and
never work.
They, for the most part, people seem to think that in America, not worldwide, because it's an irrational argument that laziness causes poverty in terms of worldwide poverty, because that's obviously not true. But in terms of only America, everyone that I know believes that, you know, poverty in America is due to laziness. And that if you work hard enough, you should absolutely be able to have basic necessities.
Well, you know the wrong people.
You work
people.
Hard, you put yourself through school.
You know the wrong people, that's Molly. You travel to Alabama.
Ultimately believe.
They ultimately do, because they need to travel to the poverty places in America. You will go to anywhere in cities where there's mass unemployment. You see lines of hundreds and hundreds of people, thousands of people, many who have a college degree, in line for the mm-hmm. same job. They want to work. And the idea that socialism will create laziness is a farce. It is not a good argument. You simply have to go back to when we were children. As we were children, before we were forced to go out into the workforce to get a job and take care of ourselves, we were creative, we were curious, we were ambitious,
mm-hmm.
we had lots and lots of hope. It's when we got out there in life and found out that life wasn't the Shangri-La that our parents presented to us as we grew up, that we became hopeless. It's when there are not enough jobs, good jobs, that can provide a person with the basic necessities of life that cause the problem. Those people who say that socialism will cause laziness have never, number one, been in a socialist country. Number two, do not know poor families, impoverished families. We have a big problem with the Ellen DeGeneres and the Oprah Winfrey's and the Wendy Williams and all these popular talk show hosts of the world. They cater to people that are of the middle class. They do no stories on poverty. They don't get a family or a mother on their show that mm-hmm. is forced, because she doesn't have enough payments coming through welfare, to take care of her children without a good job. We got some bad connection going through there. Anyway, Molly, go ahead with your final comment. They're great comments, by the way. Appreciate those comments, and I hope you continue to follow this movement. Call the show each week. Challenge things. That's what we need people to do, is to challenge what we're about.
My final question would just simply be, would this plan hurt small businesses? I think of small businesses right now have a lot of like tax incentives on. I believe they can write off their rent, and or I guess it kind of depends. If they own the place, I don't think they can, but like a lot of them can write off a lot of things on taxes. And if we put this plan into effect, they basically won't be paying any taxes, so you can get help. But if, you know, we are going to do the 25%, actually, I haven't looked at the worldwide plan. I was just looking at the one for America. I don't know if it's different, the tax plan worldwide.
Okay, what you need to do to understand it is go to the blog, mm-hmm. the blog on the Humanity Party website, www.humanityparty.com. The last blog post is called "The Humanity Party's Fair Tax Plan: How to Pay for Government and Social Programs." In there, we reveal the truth, not the stuff that people complain about. You're going to hear a lot of people talk about, we can't have big government. We got to put to get rid of government, put it back in private hands. No, no, mm-hmm. no. That has never worked. It'll never work.
Mm-hmm.
And in there, the tax plan is presented, and you'll see how that will work. There's various mm-hmm. explanations of mom-pop stores, how it will unite them. But
I think when people say big government, they necessarily mean they don't want anyone controlling them more and taxing them more. And I think
that's
that
right.
This plan will be mistaken as, oh, more government control and more taxes. But this is actually less control and less taxes. So to
exactly
me, I don't necessarily
right.
think it's a big government plan. It's just a united, like a world,
that's right.
everyone in the world saying, this is stupid. What are we doing?
That's right. It's trying to get the people to support a government that serves them. Governments are served by the people, and that is not the correct way to see it. A government is set up to serve the people. So read, you got to study a lot about these things, and our presentation of the Fair Tax Plan is something that Bernie Sanders and no Democrat or no politician even knows. They present all these ideas of change and these social programs, free education, united health care. Universal health care, I'm sorry, all these different things, and they cannot tell you how they're going to finance them. The Humanity Party can. It can describe and pinpoint exactly what needs to happen to fund these programs properly, efficiently, so that it doesn't affect jobs and it creates more jobs. But all you got to do is study the plan or call into the show and ask specific questions to us, and we'll give you specific answers. But I just love the way that you're thinking, and please, during the week, if you can, as you study things, you get come with questions. This show is for us to refine the message, to be able to clearly present to the people of the world the concept of a united government and how it can change the world and help the people. We need certain things. We need challenges, man. You made a challenge earlier about charities. Talk about charities and religions who give. Have they solved anything? No. They've been around for centuries and centuries, charities and giving to the poor. They have never solved the poverty issue, and they never will. They cannot. All they do is perpetuate it and give people an excuse to justify their lifestyle by giving a little bit to the poor, thus justifying that they're okay with God.
Getting a tax write-off in return, so it really doesn't affect them at all.
Exactly. But our desire is to create a fair tax. Governments need funding, but how are they to be funded? We've come up with that. Read that. Study that proposal, the Humanity Party's Fair Tax Plan. And Molly, I think you're going to be impressed. If you're not, please call back next week, and let's discuss it, okay?
Okay. Thank you.
Hey, thank you for the call. Wonderful call, really well thought out, and that's what we need. We need challenges to the plan so that we're able to explain these things. The producers will take our words and produce eventually. What we're going to do, so you know, folks, is once the producers have acquired enough of the debates from the politicians that are running for U.S. president, especially when it gets down to two people, because that's usually what it gets down to in the United States, and they start debating. And they're asked a question. They give their answers. Producers are going to create a video of a mock debate in which Anonymous takes on the representatives or the candidates for president. They will give their answers, and Anonymous will give the answer from the Humanity Party. You will see a vast difference in the Humanity Party's answers. That's going to be a credible thing, an incredible thing when we can put that together. Let's go to our next caller. Kendra, you're on the air. Go ahead with your question or comment.
Hi, can you hear me okay?
Perfect.
You can hear me?
Yes, perfect. Go ahead.
Okay, there's a little bit of a lag, so sorry if I talk over you. Obviously this plan will work, obviously. Like, if people actually take the time to read it and study it, obviously it'll work, but it's obviously about who... whose hands we get the information to, and what, when you think about all the states and the whole country and the people that this is going to affect, the people who would get behind a plan like this, all in California. So I think that the people, in cities and in places that would get behind a plan like this are in situations where they don't really have time to be on social media necessarily, so they're not getting the information. So I think we just need to, yeah, I don't know. When I first hit the button to call in, I was just going to, you know, compliment the introduction. And, you know, I think there was no music behind it when you read it. So I think once we get it with a good video and good music, it's going to be spot on. So, I think our issue is...
The comments you're making are perfect, and you're exactly right. Apathy, the lack of involvement in political political anything. People are just sick and tired of the whole game and mess, especially when there's a presidential election coming up. It's just
right.
Political ads and rhetoric ad nauseum. People are tired of it. Even on Facebook,
right.
When people go on Facebook, they're just, everybody has their opinion.
They scroll right past it. And...
it's just, everybody's sick of it. And the fact is, most people would rather see a good joke or a good meme or some picture on Facebook that makes them laugh. And you're exactly right. All we're doing is we're presenting a foundation and a blueprint for the right world government. We're going to provide that to be available to the people of the world. And it is going to be slow going, and who knows what's going to happen. And we're going to try to, once we get the video produced for the worldwide launch of the Humanity Party and get it produced right, then we're going to get it translated into other languages. So all those out there who speak another language who would like to help in the translation of the Humanity Party's introduction, please let us know. Somehow we're going to need people from all over the world to translate these things in their language. I think, Kendra, if the world knew, and correct me if I'm wrong, but if the world knew that there was some platform of unification or some worldwide political party where people were saying, hey, enough of the war, enough of the economic insecurity that's been perpetuated throughout this world because of trade agreements and things that most people don't understand. We want a world government that'll help all people. If we can get that message out there, then it's by word of mouth, even to those people that don't have time. It might be a person who watches the video who goes to work and says, man, I just saw this cool video on the Humanity Party. Finally, we've got some political party that cares about people more than government and blah, blah. And people say, hey, that sounds cool. People talk about it. But they're not going to want to listen to this show and listen to all this rhetoric because to them it's just more political rhetoric. But they want to see that video. They'll want to see that video. And I think in the future, in the worldwide, in the worldwide Humanity Party's webpage, we haven't decided yet. We might have a kind of a signing, a place where people can sign and join, put their name to this Humanity Party. And I'm not sure if that's what the board of directors wants or not, but that's something. But the truth is, how do we convince the people, the world, that this is different, that we have the solutions, that they make sense? The main media is not going to touch us with a 10-foot pole. We are against almost everything and have solutions to the very thing that their advertisers live for. However, if we could just get the wealthy also, wealthy individuals, popular individuals, take a look at the Humanity Party, give it a chance, see what it's all about. But chances of that happening in the world like we have it, it all depends on the amount of people in the future that find out about it and start talking about it. Because that's where you get the media attention. Does that make sense?
Yes, we definitely need to get it in the younger hands. I've noticed that even with some people who tend to be more liberal, but are still kind of from an older generation, they still agree with, like, the gun laws, the right-wing gun laws. That just seems to be a huge issue for people, which I don't get at all. but I think if this information got into the majority of the people of the planet, Yes, absolutely, hands down. This is the only way. It's the only way, and I don't understand why people are not ready. And that's enough, you know.
It's kind of hard. It's kind of hard to imagine why people just don't get it. We have a friend who comes on Blog Talk Radio at 7 o'clock p.m. That person who supports the Humanity Party talks a little bit more about religion, philosophy, and those types of things. He has an incredible explanation of what's happening and what's going on in the world. Those of you who are interested can tune into that at a later time. It's Sunday evenings at 7 p.m. Eastern time. I'm sorry, 9 p.m. Eastern time in the United States. That's also Blog Talk Radio. It's called Marvelous Work and a Wonder. And on that, in that venue, I think, knowing this person, he has an incredible explanation of what's going on and what is going to happen. For example, the people who say, we got to protect our right to bear arms and have guns. Well, just wait. You give it another decade and you watch the domestic terrorism is going to happen in this country, in the United States of America. You watch how many more shootings, how many more people are killed randomly, children in schools, innocent people in malls and sporting events, theaters, all over, that are killed because of guns. And then they're going to realize that the people who are doing the killing, doesn't matter how many background checks you would have done on them, they still, at some point in their life, mind went a little bit crazy, decided to take people's lives. The only way to eliminate that is to eliminate guns and put them in the hands of a well-regulated militia, as was the intent of the founders of the United States. Kendra, thank you for your calls and your support, and call in any time. And
yes,
we'll
discuss. I'm looking forward to this video.
Good. So are we. It will be. Thanks, Kendra.
Yeah.
We'll talk about it. It's going to be a few months before our producers have that ready. They're excited about it. They needed this script to be able to take it from there. And it just takes time, because this is really what we did before, is put out the Vote Anonymous video. This is an introduction to the Humanity Party, which is a worldwide political movement to unite all the people of the world together. It will be wonderful and interesting to see how the producers put this together. Let's go to our next caller, Lorena. Hi, you're on the air. Go ahead with your question or your comment.
Hi, I just have a concern that I wanted to bring up that you could explain for me and for us. You just posted a blog, I believe, on the Humanity Party website about it has the verbiage of a new world order. And anytime I've heard of a new world order before the Humanity Party came about, it was always a negative thing. It was what's happening with the current political people right now, and it's just very negative. It's like a police state type feeling. It's got a lot of an association to people out there right now currently that's very negative. And so I was just wondering if you can explain how you're different than the current new world order being proposed.
Well, that's very easy. There are a lot of people out there who to take a new world order as a negative thing. And the best way to counter them is to ask them, why would it be wrong or not in the best interest of human beings to have a new world of laws and orders that create peace and unity among us? See, the problem is semantics. We don't know what else to call it. There needs to be a one-world government. And that scares people because they're not educated. And many people that are religious, who believe in their religion and
exactly.
that their God is the proper God, or their Savior, their Messiah, their prophet is the one who is going to save the world. Because they have that belief, any other movement out there that occurs that counters their value system created by their religion, it becomes their devil, their Satan, their Lucifer. Therefore, they fight it, thinking that it's not from their God. This is from human beings. This has nothing to do with religion. It has to do with human beings wanting to live together in peace and harmony. And I understand exactly where you're coming from, Lorena. There's a book entitled 666, The Mark of America, The Seat of the Beast. When that book first came out, nobody would touch it because of the title. Everybody thought that the author of the book was calling the United States something of the devil. And it has nothing to do with the devil. But it does have to do with the economic power and the way the United States controls the world in economics through its policies and its money. But just in the title itself, and like you said, back to what you're saying, which makes perfect sense, what else could we call it? And again, right, facts are those people who don't want a new world order are, they're not going to accept the Humanity Party anyway. They already have their minds set up on whatever it might be, like I said, some religious belief or whatever. So they would never get behind this anyway. As we translate those words into other languages, that's very important to understand. It's very clear to translate new world order and a one world government into other languages. And once it does, once we do, the people in the world, they're not going to relate that type of verbiage to a negative connotation like people in the United States do, usually among fanatical religious groups of people. That makes sense?
Yeah, I was just concerned that it might be associated with the current New World Order talk happening out there. Because it's so different. I just was concerned about the verbiage.
The fact is, more than likely, this movement that we're starting now in 2015 isn't even going to take hold until maybe the next generation. But it needs to be started. We're the adults of the next generation. We are their progenitors. We are their ancestors. We have a duty and a responsibility to future generations, to our children, which are future generations, to propose a solution to the problems that we have allowed, that we have created, and that we are doing nothing about. So those who join the movement of the Humanity Party can rest assured when their life is done that they've done everything in their power to create a new world, a better world for succeeding generations and for their children and grandchildren. That's all they can do. That's all they can. But if we do nothing, and we do what everybody else is doing out there, nothing, and we let politics be status quo, and the governments of the world continue to be sovereign and fight and argue and attack each other, we have no right to look at our children and grandchildren and tell them that we are not part of the problems that they then will experience. So we're going to do the best that we can, and that's all we can do. But your word, Lorena, think about over time, if you can think about something during the week that might be a better verbiage, we'll consider it. But again, we have to consider all the people of the world and how those words are translated into their language. Okay, and how it comes about. For Spanish people, for example, un orden del mundo is powerful. Okay, the Humanity Party is pretty soon, very, very soon, going to release the Vote Anonymous, the first video in Spanish. Incredible. The person whose voice is used is Spanish is clear, concise, incredible. Sent chills up our spines when we listened to that. Because I speak Spanish, of course, I understood what he was saying. And it was incredible. We believe that if that gets out there, the Spanish people, now that they can understand what the video's about, it'll probably go more viral, have more hits than the English version, because those people are the ones who are being affected by government policy, especially the immigration nonsense that is being proposed in the Republican Party, and for which the Democratic Party, an independent party, no political party has any clue how to solve. The Humanity Party knows how to solve it fairly, equitably, that creates jobs and peace and security for everyone. Anyway, any more comments?
Well, that's, see, I was just wanting to make sure that this new world order that's currently out there, that the Humanity Party has the real solutions, and is what I am so grateful to be a part of, and to want to spread the word about this other new world order that's out there is just got all this negative association. So I just wanted to bring up that it is not associated, and that it's an actual new world order with the real solutions, not associated with the current political system, new world order happening.
Well, we wish we could talk to those people who believe in that conspiracy, that there's some conspiratorial new world order taking place behind the scenes. It's just not happening. There isn't. There is no body or group of people that sit around and determine. Well, that's not true. They do determine the financial economic means of the world, but not to cause problems. They're doing the best that they can, and that's the problem. What we want to do is unite the wealthy, those who think they're educated and learned, with everyone else. We want to unite together and present the proper solutions so there's no more conspiracy. They're simply human beings living, getting up in the morning, going to work, establishing relationships that they value, and having security upon this earth. So when you talk to people out there, especially those who are of religious nature, ask them this. Because many people in the United States of America are Christians, and they believe in a second coming of Jesus. God's going to save the world. Ask him this simple, simple question. So when your Jesus comes, is he not going to establish a one-world order and a one-world government? End of story.
Perfect. Thank you.
It just so happens that maybe there's a plan, one like unto that type of plan that would work then. If that were to occur, that is here now, that we can all get behind and make it happen. Anyway, thanks for the call, Arena. Appreciate it. Great comments. Let's go to our next caller here. Let's go to Lily. You're on the air. Go ahead with your question or comment. You said you have a question or comment about the verbiage of the New World Order. Please.
Well, I thought it was very interesting at what Lorena was talking about, because there is a kind of a negative connotation, but that has been around and has existed since I was a kid. That paranoia is an old, long-running, tired paranoia, and it has yet to happen. And what I find fascinating is that ever since I can remember thinking about voting, you know, in my civics class in high school, preparing me to go out and be a responsible citizen of the country and vote, and having taken an interest. I think I stopped voting in the Clinton administration. I think he was the last candidate that I voted for, because even before him, nothing really changed. Everybody comes along, all the candidates, and they do their best to tell you how they're going to change. And, you know, and the new verbiage for now is the morality and the values and this and the thing and that and the other, whatever. Always a new order, some new idea. But the fact is, nothing ever really changes for better. And in fact, everything's getting worse. And in my mind, I'm thinking, well, yes, people are paranoid about the new world order. They have been for as long as I can remember. And yet, regimes have come and gone in other countries. And, you know, mass tragedies and all kinds of terrible things have happened in all places all over the world. And that was somebody's idea of an order or something new they were going to institute. And has it helped the world? No. Nothing's changed. And the only sensible solutions or answers that I have ever heard of have been through Vote Anonymous and the Humanity Party. And what does it matter, like you were saying, what does it matter if it's called a new world order? It's semantics. Something needs to change because the world isn't getting any better. And it occurs to me that that kind of paranoia can go away if people like myself or those who have studied the new constitution, this Vote Anonymous and Humanity Party's platform, and really given it time, that they'll see that it is a beneficial world order for everyone. And that's the information that I'll pass on to, say, like my own grandchildren, kids that I know. And that stigma of a new world order can change. That's how it has to happen. There's no other way, because we do have people who are stuck in an old idea or who believe the current, you know, nonsense that is played out on the media every day.
Well, very well
spot on.
Very well said, Lily, and you're exactly right. It's our responsibility as parents and grandparents, as the children and grandchildren begin to grow and associate themselves with life and see the problems associated with being on their own. We can only say and tell them by our experience what works and what does not. We can tell them point blank and with all honesty and clarity that nothing that has been tried during our lifetimes or the lifetimes of our grandparents and great-grandparents has ever worked, ever. There must be a different way, a new way, and it has to come. Because the people of the world, especially their economic situations, are becoming so tied into each other, we must learn, we must establish a new way to control all those things for the sake and benefit of everybody equally upon the earth. That's the goal of the Humanity Party. There is no other party out there that exists like that, none.
No, it's true.
And
I'm
that's
with
what
you,
we're
Voice
trying
Humanity.
To do.
Okay. Go, Voice Humanity. Thanks. Bye.
Thanks so much, Lily. Have a good one. Folks, all these are great comments. Again, those of you who are interested in launching and establishing the Humanity Party, this time on Sunday evenings at 6 o'clock Eastern Standard Time in the United States, is the time for you to challenge the things that we have put out there as the Humanity Party. When you talk to your friends or you see comments and they make sense, a lot of the comments and challenges to the Humanity Party don't make any sense at all. But what we're doing is taking literally common sense, not book sense, not educated sense, but the common sense that is innate in each human being that exists in this world. And we're speaking to that common sense to help point out to them that this world is in a confused situation because nobody has the answers. The Humanity Party has the answers. No other colors. We'll see you next week. Thanks for joining us this week. You gotta believe.
I ask the Lord once more request. I Father, as you see, I'm just a child. And there's so much to understand. But if your grace sits around me, then I'll do the best I can. I promise I'll do the very best I can.